إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله، الله أكبر ولله الحمد. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين علي ولي الله، أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا حجة الله. حيا على الصلاة، حيا على الصلاة، حيا على الفلاح، حيا على الفلاح، حي على خير العمل، حي على خير العمل. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله. اللهم اجعل قلبي بارا وعيشي قارا ورزقي دارا وعملي سارا وأولادي أبرارا، واجعلني عند قبر نبيك محمد المصطفى صلى الله عليه وآله مستقرا وقرارا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله،
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد،
أشهد أن محمد رسول الله،
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد،
أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا ولي الله،
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد،
أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا حجة الله،
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح، حي على خير العمل، حي على خير العمل. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا محسن قد أتاك المسيء، وقد أمرت المحسن أن يتجاوز عن المسيء. أنت المحسن وأنا المسيء بحق محمد وآل محمد. صل على محمد وآل محمد وتجاوز عنك به ما تعلم مني. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر الله أكبر سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد الله أكبر بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد كذلك الله ربي الله أكبر اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أفضل ما صليت وباركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم صل على محمد وآله في كل وقت وكل أوان وعلى كل حال ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار رب عاملنا بفضلك ولا تعاملنا بعدلك يا وهاب يا جواد يا كريم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم الله أكبر سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد الله أكبر الحمد لله كما هو أهله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وتقبل شفاعته وارفع درجته بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد الله أكبر سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد يا لطيف ارحم عبدك الضعيف يا ولي العافية أسألك العافية عافية الدين وزينة الآخرة يا كريم.
الله أكبر، الحمد لله كما هو أحمد، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته، السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه.
أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم الرحمن الرحيم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليك. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم الرحمن الرحيم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليك. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم الرحمن الرحيم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد يا من أرجوه لكل خير وعمن سخطه عند كل شر يا من يعطي الكثير بالقليل يا من يعطي من سأل يا من يعطي من لم يسأله ومن لم يعرفه تحننا منه ورحمة أعطني بمسألتي إياك جميع خير الدنيا وجميع خير الآخرة واصرف عني بمسألتي إياك جميع شر الدنيا وشر الآخرة فإنه غير منقوص ما أتيت وزدني من فضلك يا كريم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا ذا النعماء والجود يا ذا المن والتول حرم شيبتي على النار برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله
صل على محمد وآل محمد
أشهد أن محمد رسول الله
صل على محمد وآل محمد
أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين علي ولي الله
صل على محمد وآل محمد
أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وأولاده المعصومين بالحق حجج الله
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير العمل حي على خير العمل قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم اغفر لي ولوالدي ولجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر سلام يا حتى مطلع الفجر الله أكبر
سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد كذلك الله ربي الله أكبر اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى جميع الأنبياء الله ورسله وملائكته اللهم لعن أول ظالم ظلم حق محمد وآل محمد وآخر تابع له على ذلك اللهم لعن العصابة التي جاهدت الحسين وشايعت وبايعت وتابعت على قتله اللهم لعنهم جميعا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم وأهلك أعداهم الله أكبر سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر الحمد لله كما هو أهله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وتقبل شفاعته وارفع درجته بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد الله أكبر
سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد يا خير المسؤولين ويا خير المعطين ارزقني وارزق عيالي من فضلك فإنك ذا الفضل العظيم وأنت الجواد الكريم يا خير الرازقين
الله أكبر الحمد لله كما هو أهله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه.
أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم الرحمن الرحيم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا من أرجوه لكل خير وآمنوا سخطه عند كل شر. يا من يعطي الكثير بالقليل. يا من يعطي من سأله. يا من يعطي من لم يسعنه ومن لم يعرفه تحننا منه ورحمة. أعطني بمسعنتي إياك جميع خير الدنيا وجميع خير الآخرة، واصرف عني بمسعنتي إياك جميع شر الدنيا وشر الآخرة، فإنه غير منقوص ما أعطيت، وزدني من فضلك يا كريم، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا النعماء والجود، يا ذا المن والطول، حرم شيبتي عن النار برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك يا نبي الله، السلام عليك يا حبيب الله، السلام عليك يا رسول الله، السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين، سيد الوصيين، إمام المتقين، السلام عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء، سيدتي نساء العالمين، السلام عليك يا خديجة الكبرى، أم المؤمنين، السلام عليك يا حسن المجتبى، السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك، عليك مني سلام الله عبدا ما بقيت وبكي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر الأهد مني لزيارتكم، السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى صحاب الحسين، السلام عليك يا شهداء كربلاء جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته، السلام عليك يا غريب الغرباء، السلام عليك يا معين الضعفاء والفقراء، سلطان أبا الحسن مولانا علي بن موسى الرضا، كن شفيعنا وشفيع والدينا في يوم الجزاء، السلام عليك وعلى أختك فاطمة المعصومة ورحمة الله وبركاته، السلام عليك يا مولانا يا صاحب الأسر والزمان، السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن، السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن، الأمان 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 من فتنة الزمان. عجل الله تعالى فرجك وسهل الله مخرجك وظهورك واجعلنا من أنصارك وشيعتك ومحبك. السلام عليك وعلى آبائك الطاهرين ورحمة الله وبركاته. اللهم صل على
سمجھ کے سارا قدم قدم پہ لایا گیا سکینہ کو.
محمد وآل محمد صلوات.
سمجھ کے ظاہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو. سمجھ کے ظاہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو. قدم قدم پہ قدم قدم پہ رلایا گیا سکینہ کو. سمجھ کے ظاہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو. طلب کیا کسی ظالم نے جب کنیزی میں. چھپا لیا اسے زینب نے اپنی گودی میں. نہ پوچھو کیسے نہ پوچھو کیسے بچایا گیا سکینہ کو. سمجھ کے ظاہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو. وہ پشت ناک پہ تنہا وہ تیز رفتاری سنبھلتی کیسے سفر میں حسین کی پیاری, گری نہیں ہے گری نہیں ہے, گرایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, سر حسین کو تکتے تھے عابد مستر, ترپنے لگتی تھی غازی کی لاش دریا پر, تماچا جب بھی تماچا جب بھی لگایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, وہ اپنا حال یتیمی سنانے آئی تھی, پدر کی لاش سے پتھر ہٹانے آئی تھی, لگا کے درے لگا کے درے ہٹایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, رباب بین یہ تربت پہ آ کے کرتی تھی, غریب ہو گئی کتنی حسین کی بیٹی, گلی گلی میں گلی گلی میں پھرایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, حجاب غیب کا مالک وہ درد رکھتا ہے, اٹھائے مشک تکلم تلاش کرتا ہے, کہاں پہ پانی کہاں پہ پانی پلایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, قدم قدم پہ قدم قدم پہ رلایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, سمجھ کے زہرا ستایا گیا سکینہ کو, پر محمد والے محمد صلوات.
اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم, بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم, لا حول ولا قوة الا باللہ العلی العظیم, حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل نعم المولى ونعم النصير. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي ذكره شرف للذاكرين وشكره فوز للشاكرين وطاعته نجاة للمطيعين. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين وحبيب إله العالمين سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا الرسول الأمجد المحمود الأحمد رحمة للعالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى تمام عدة المرسلين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولو أنما في الأرض من شجرة أقلام والبحر يمده من بعده سبعة أبحر ما نفدت كلمات الله إن الله عزيز حكيم. آمنا بالله وصدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in Surah Luqman, Surah number 31, verse 27, and were all of the trees in this world to be made as pens, and were all of the seas to be made as ink, surely the words of Allah would never expire. Surely you would never be able to write all of the words of Allah, and Allah is mighty and wise. Dear brothers and sisters, dear elders, salamu alaykum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A common complaint we find within our community is that the Shias in general do not know a lot about the Imams outside of Imam Ali and Imam al-Husayn alayhim as-salam. We generally don't know about the sidelined Imams, Imams like Imam al-Kadhim, Imams like Imam al-Hadi, Imams like Imam al-Jawad. And generally the scholars and people complain that we don't know enough about them and we need to know more about them. Generally we complain that we spend too much time only focusing on Imam Ali and Imam al-Husayn, and yet we don't really know much about these other Imams, even though all of their statuses are technically equal. So today what I thought I would do is I would look into the life of Imam al-Hadi, talk about some things that stick out from his life and some things that we can learn from his life. Because surely all of the Imams were lights of guidance for us, and we should not sideline all of them, any of them. If we talk about the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, and we are Shias of Imam al-Hadi, how many of you can name to me three or four quotes of Imam al-Hadi? This is surely a failing of the Shia community that we cannot freely talk about any of our Imams of guidance. We tell people about the 12 Imams, we tell people we are followers of 14 infallibles. If they picked one of the infallibles and randomly asked you a question about them, could you answer that confidently? So today what I thought is I'd talk a bit about Imam al-Hadi and his life, because we are commemorating his Shahada. And inshallah we'll find a few things that we can learn from his life. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Imam al-Hadi's mother was a woman by the name of Sumana al-Maghribiya. As all of you know, the Imams from Imam al-Sadiq down to Imam al-Askari would marry African women. And the mother of Imam al-Hadi was actually a woman from Maghrib, meaning Morocco. We find that some history books, such as the book of Allama Baqir Sharif al-Qarashi, Zishan Haider Jawadi in his book, The Life Sketch of Imam al-Hadi, they suggest that at the times of Imam al-Ridha and Imam al-Hadi, these two Imams were actually teased for being the mother of a black slave. Now here it is interesting, and it is interesting to look at the genealogy of their mothers. We find that the Imams from Imam al-Sadiq and Imam al-Asqari married African women. And we find in the descriptions that people like Imam al-Hadi were dark-skinned in their complexion. The only reason why I wanted to contemplate on this is if we think about it, if Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-Sharif, if he was to reappear tomorrow, his mothers and grandmothers were all from Africa. So technically, Imam al-Mahdi will be of a darker complexion. Now, when we normally think about our Imam, I know many of us may not think about his visage, his face, his appearance, but when we think about him of a man with face of Noor, you know, a light-skinned face, a beautiful face. Go towards Iraq, all of the pictures of the Imams, how are they depicted? They are depicted how we think they look. You know, these Iraqis with some very beautiful thick beards. However, what if Imam al-Mahdi came back tomorrow and he was dark-skinned? How many Shias around the world would freely accept him as their Imam? Just an interesting point to think about. Because right from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, the Ahlul Bayt always tried to do away with racism, from putting Bilal as the Grand Mu'adhin of Medina, down to the Imam al-Sadiq to Imam al-Asqari marrying African women. Never did they allow any racism to come within our communities. Now, I'm not saying racism is within our community. I'm just saying it's something to ponder upon. And sometimes we find that we may have casual racism within us. Something which is subtle, hidden. We don't really realize it. But just as I said, we may not be racist towards black people, but if Imam al-Mahdi came tomorrow and he was black, would we freely accept him? Or would there be something, a barrier stopping us, that would make us have to, you know, slowly accept him rather than accept him freely? Are we expecting a man with an Iraqi complexion or a very fine, fair skin complexion with nur, as we normally say it, shining out of his face to come back? Do we really realize what he might be like? Just a point to think about, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. We find from a young age, Imam al-Hadi was known for his knowledge and known for his beauty in Islamic asceticism. We find he was separated from his father at a young age because Imam al-Jawad was imprisoned by the caliphs of the time. And we find that the Abbasid caliphs tried to give Imam al-Hadi a teacher who was an enemy of al-Muhammad. One day, the people of Medina asked this teacher, how's your lessons going with that boy? He turned to them and he said, how dare you call him a boy? He's my sheikh. Whenever I go to teach him, I find his knowledge surpasses mine. This boy has memorized the Quran from back to front. Before we start the class, I always ask him, can you recite a surah from the Quran? He asks me, which one would you like to recite? I ask him all of the long surahs, recite them for me. And he recites them in such a beautiful voice. This boy knows the Quran from back to front. He knows its revelation and he knows its tafsir. This boy is not just a boy. Don't ever call him a boy. He is a sheikh. Treat him as a sheikh. And this is from the age of about 6 years of age. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. We found Imam al-Hadi in Medina. His popularity started to grow as he started to grow older. The caliphs became very annoyed at this, but despite this, he took this opportunity to teach. And you found in Medina, his house would be like a university for people to come to. You found he would expound on the traditions of Rasulullah, the traditions of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He would give masail of fiqh. He would narrate du'as to people, such that if you go to du'as.org and search Imam al-Naqi, you find that there are about 40 du'as that come from Imam Ali al-Naqi alayhi salam. You find the ziyaras that come from Imam Ali al-Naqi alayhi salam. He has left behind a wealth of knowledge that many of us are actually ignorant of, that we don't even know about. It becomes a responsibility upon us to go and look at these. Yes, many of these du'as are slightly short. Many of them are only a few lines long. But anything that comes out of the Ahlul Bayt must be something that we pay attention to, because they don't talk out of their own desire. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. These are the Imams of Al-Muhammad. They do not speak out of their own desire. Everything they say is a revelation revealed to them. We find they took this opportunity to spread knowledge, and I'll talk a bit more about this knowledge later on. And we found, because of this rising popularity of the Imam, the caliphs became very annoyed with him. The leaders of the state became very annoyed with him. They wanted to get rid of him. And you found he lived across many Abbasid khalifas. Now, many of you may have heard that the Abbasids, if anything, were worse than the Umayyads in their oppression of al-Muhammad. And you find that at the time of Imam al-Hadi, the Alawids, those descendants of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the Shia, were very much oppressed. Now, we always say this, but I'd like to outline what exactly the oppression was. You see, people like Mutawakkil al-Abbasi, one of the caliphs at the time of Imam al-Hadi, yes, they were very corrupt. They used to drink wine, they used to have maid servants that obviously used to quench their desires, let's say. They used to, you know, listen to lots of music, they used to have lots of palaces, they used to be very lavish. You know, we mentioned this about all of the caliphs. But Mutawakkil al-Abbasi, he is known for his strong hatred for al-Muhammad, such that in Medina he imposed an economic blockade on the Alawids. Similar to the boycott that happened to Rasulullah, where you find Rasulullah and his people would have to be eating grass when they were in the Shi'ab of Abi Talib. The people of Medina, the Alawids, the descendants of Amir al-Mu'mineen in Medina, had an economic blockade, where people were told, if you ever pay anything to them, if you ever trade with them, we will punish you. You found, for example, that in Medina, there would be houses of women. They would have one chadar between them for salat, and they used to share this chadar. You found many of them were very poor and very sidelined in society simply because they were lovers of al-Muhammad. But Mutawakkil al-Abbas's hatred could be seen from one thing as well. And that is that he time and again would try to destroy the shrine of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. You find in history some people say he attacked the shrine for up to 40 times he attacked the shrine and tried to destroy it. He would raise the shrine towards the ground. And he would order his people to try and get rid of any remembrance of the shrine by making water flood the land. However, the miracle that happened was that the water would do tawaf around the shrine of Imam al-Husayn. Never would it flood above it. Because even the people of this earth and the creatures of this earth know the status of Al-Muhammad better than their oppressors. As Allah says in the Quran, يُرِيدُونَ لِيُدْفِعُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. They desire to put the light of Allah out with their actions, but Allah will complete His light, even if the kafirs and the mushriks do not like it. You found Imam al-Hadi, this is perhaps why Imam al-Hadi used to encourage people to go towards Aba Abdullah. You found, for example, Imam al-Hadi was ill once. One of his companions by the name of Abu Hashim comes in. Imam al-Hadi says to him, pay somebody at my expense to go towards the shrine of Imam al-Husayn and to pray for me. So Abu Hashim says, no problem. He goes outside, he finds a companion by the name of Ali ibn Bilal. He says to him, Imam al-Hadi has ordered me to send you towards the shrine of Imam al-Husayn to pray for his good health. Ali ibn Bilal turns to him and he says, but he is also an imam. Why is he asking me to go towards the shrine of Imam al-Husayn? Abu Hashim comes back to Imam al-Hadi and he says, he's raised a good point. He said to me, look, you are also an Imam of Ahlul Bayt. Your status is equal to that of Aba Abdullah. Why are you asking us to go towards the shrine of Imam al-Husayn? Imam al-Hadi replied to him. He said, go back to that companion Ali ibn Bilal and tell him, Rasulullah did tawaf of the Kaaba and Rasulullah kissed Hajar al-Aswad. Even though Rasulullah was greater than the Kaaba and he was greater than Hajar al-Aswad. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has certain places within this earth where He loves to be called upon. And the shrine of Imam al-Husayn is one of those places. Therefore tell him to go towards the shrine of Imam al-Husayn and pray for me. Because surely the status of that shrine is so exalted. On this note, we celebrated the birthday of Imam al-Baqir 2 days ago. So I'd like to narrate a narration from him about the turba of Imam al-Husayn. Once a companion came to, he was told about a companion who was extremely ill and who was bedridden. He had lost energy, he had lost, you know, a lot of health. It seemed as though he was on his deathbed. Imam al-Baqir sent him a drink with khaki shifa. They made him drink that drink. And this companion became so healthy, he said, I was never as healthy as this before this. He comes towards Imam al-Baqir and he says, what did you mix in that drink? He says, I mixed the drink of khaki shifa from Imam al-Husayn's shrine. And then he added to him, he said, if I was to use my turba for that same purpose, would it achieve the purpose? He said to him, no, because you don't know how to respect the turba. So the companion said to him, okay, give me some khaki shifa and I will respect it. I will give it much more respect and I will use it when I need it. He said to him, what are you going to do if I gave you this turba? He said, I'm going to put it into my clothes to make sure it stays safe. He says, but you've already disobeyed it. You've already given it less respect. You're meant to treat this turba like gold. You see, we kind of just put this turba down and we pray on it. But sometimes we lose the appreciation of this. This turba about whom Imam Zamana says, As-salamu ala man ja'ala Allah shifa'a fi turbata. As-salamu ala man al-ijabatu tahta qubbata. Peace be upon the one who Allah has made shifa' in his turba. You know Imam al-Baqir alayhi afdal salati wa salam. He's narrated to have said that make sure you visit Karbala before you pass away so that when you go to heaven you are not a stranger. Isn't it beautiful that we say that Karbala is a part of heaven? Salat is mi'raj, correct? A mi'raj towards the heaven. What better to pray on than a piece of heaven itself? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. A point I just added in just so that we can appreciate the high status, the sanctity of this turba greater, something that even I was ignorant of and I've started to apply more in my life now as well. This turba needs to be respected, and Imam al-Hadi outlined this to his people. Despite the strong hatred of Mutawakkil al-Abbasi towards Imam al-Husayn's shrine, trying to destroy it. Do you know why this started? Because one of Mutawakkil's maidservants went towards Imam al-Husayn in the month of Sha'ban. He called for that maidservant and he didn't know that she was on ziyarah. And they told him that she has, you know, gone on hajj, or she's gone on a pilgrimage. When she came back, they said to him, she said to her, where did you go? How did you go to hajj in the month of Sha'ban? She said to him, I went towards Aba Abdullah. He heard how people used to flock there. And he did not like this one bit. and therefore he exhibited his hatred towards Al Muhammad. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Now, you may start to question, you know, the people at the time, they saw that the shrine of Abu Abdullah was being destroyed. How comes they never gave out a stronger voice against it? How comes there was never a stronger revolution against it? And according to people like Zishan Haydar Jawadi in his book, The Life Sketch of Imam Al-Hadi, he said the Caliph Mutawakkil Al-Abbasi would distract people by causing religious experts or people that looked like scholars to spread religious deviation in society. So for example, it's a long-standing debate in Islamic history about justice. Some people would say, for example, it is full free will. We have complete free will. Some people would say, no, it is complete predestination. Allah has predestined everything that will happen in this earth. And therefore, you find people used to become confused. There used to be atheists that used to be paid in order to spread heresies, spread the fact that there is no God, to confuse the people. And what happens is when the theology of the people is confused, their life is also confused. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know where to go. They don't know how to act upon society. He would cause confusion amongst people by spreading religious heresies everywhere. Isn't it interesting today how many religious differences do we have that cause us to also be disunited? And it's this disunity that stops us from being able to make the right steps in society. How did Imam Al-Hadi react to all of this? How does Imam Al-Hadi try to bring the community back towards Al-Muhammad? Doing exactly that. He used to spread the fada'il of Muhammad and Al-Muhammad throughout his life. And he used to do it at opportunities where you wouldn't even have imagined. Think about it. For example, one companion once wrote him a letter and said that people are spreading that it's full free will and other scholars are spreading that it's full predestination. We are now confused on the matter. Can you explain the matter to us? Imam Al-Hadi, if you read his letter, really and truly, if he wanted to answer the question, he could have come out straight away and given the classic answer, which he gives at the end. That it is neither full free will nor is it full predestination. It is al-amr bayn al-amrayn. It is half and half. Why? Because we cannot have full predestination, because then it would be unjust of Allah to punish us for our actions and to reward us for our actions if He's making us do it. But it also cannot be full free will, because Allah is powerful above us. We didn't choose which country we were born in. We did not choose which religion we were born in. We did not choose which gender we were. Therefore, there were things that Allah had power over, but there were things that Allah allowed us to have free will in. But he doesn't only answer like that. He starts off his answer with something completely different. He says, Rasulullah has said that the Ummah will not agree upon something which is a deviation. The Ummah will not agree upon something which is a deviation. And he says, there is one hadith which the Ummah agrees upon. If they follow it, they will not go towards deviation. That hadith was Hadith al-Thaqalain. That Rasulullah says, I leave behind two weighty things, Quran and Ahlul Bayt. If you hang on to both of them, never will you go astray. Tell me something. They asked him about justice. They asked him about free will and predestination. He could have given a simple answer and said, Al-Amr bayn al-Amrayn. Why start with the fada'il of the hadith of Thaqalain? Why start by reminding people of Thaqalain? Another example I'll give you. Al-Mutawakkil al-Abbasi asked Ibn Sikkit, who was a Shia actually working in the government. He told him, go towards Imam al-Hadi and ask him a difficult question. So he goes up to Imam al-Hadi and he asks him. He says to him, why was Prophet Musa given the miracle of magic? And why was Prophet Isa given the miracle of medicine? And why was Rasulullah given the miracle of the Quran? Why different miracles for different prophets? Why can't they have all of the miracles or the same miracle? He turns to him and he says, Prophet Musa came at a time where the magicians were the people that were very respected in society, where magic was something that was amazing in society. So Allah gave Prophet Musa magic in order to destroy that which they found amazing in their society. At Prophet Isa's time, people had come out and become experts in medicine. Therefore, we gave Prophet Isa the miracle of medicine. And at the time of Rasulullah, people were geniuses and brilliant at eloquence. Their poetry had reached a stage they had not reached before. So we give Rasulullah an eloquent Quran in order to destroy their eloquence, such that until today, nobody has been able to make a surah like the surah of the Quran. But he doesn't stop there. The answer is finished. He asks him, why did Rasulullah get the miracle of the Quran? He carries on. He says, but alongside that Quran, Rasulullah was given the Amir al-Mu'mineen and his sword. And by the sword of Ali, he would annihilate the oppressors and he would annihilate the munafiqeen and the mushrikeen. It was by the sword of Ali that he would humble these Arabs. These Arabs at the time of Jahiliyyah, they used to be known for their bravery. They used to consider it cowardice to actually run away from battlefield. But after the coming of Amir al-Mu'mineen, they used to say it is a shame to run away from battle, except when you're running away from Ali, because Ali is different. Ya Ali. Ibn Sikit, this companion, just to prove to you he was a companion. If you go towards history books, Mutawakkil al-Abbasi made him the teacher of his children. His children, when they come to him and we say, we think that this person is against you, we believe he's a follower of Al-Muhammad. So Mutawakkil decides to test him. He goes towards Ibn Sikit and he says to him, who's more honorable, my children or Hassan and Hussein? Ibn Sikit turns around to him and he says, forget Hassan and Hussein. You and your children are nothing compared to Qanbar, the servant of Ali. Mutawakkil al-Abbasi reacts. You know what he does? He orders them to take his tongue out from the back of his head and to torture him until he passes away. Imam al-Hadi, when he was at a young age, and the Caliph Mu'tasim would send the man Yahya ibn Aktham, famous for his debates with Imam al-Jawad, he would send him towards Imam al-Hadi and say to him, ask him some questions so that we can try and prove him wrong and prove that he is not so knowledgeable. So he'd ask him a number of questions which are recorded in the books and which are too lengthy for the discussion today. He would ask him questions such as, why was in the Quran when Prophet Sulaiman asked someone to bring the throne of Bilqis for him? Why does he ask someone to bring the throne of Bilqis for him? Can he not do it himself? He says, Allah wanted Asif ibn Barqiyah to bring the throne of Bilqis in the blink of an eye, so that it could be proved that he was the successor of Prophet Sulaiman. They asked him, you know, how did Asif ibn Barqiyah do that, not being a successor of the Prophet? They said he was granted one name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the greatest names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam al-Sadiq in one narration says, there are 73 of the greatest names of Allah. Asif was granted one, we are granted 72. Imagine what we could do with our power. Imam al-Hadi in that discussion answers many other questions, but one of the questions was about the verse I recited at the start, Surah 31, verse 27. وَلَوْ أَنَّ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٍ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعَدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. Were all the trees in this earth to become pens and all the seas to become ink, the words of Allah would never be able to be written. Then he was asked, what are these seas and what are these words? So he would name seven seas. He'd name the Sea of Barahud, the Sea of Yemen, the Sea of Ceylon, etc. And he'd say, the words of Allah are the fada'il of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. For surely were you to get every single tree in this earth and every single sea and make it into ink, you would never be able to write down the fada'il of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You found throughout his life, Imam al-Hadi was stressing upon the fada'il of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. He was stressing upon the Ahlul Bayt and bringing people towards Ahlul Bayt. Why? Why such an emphasis on just bringing people towards Ahlul Bayt? Why not explain why what they're saying is wrong? Why always start with fada'il of Muhammad and al-Muhammad? Because as Bibi Fatima says, that it is through our wilaya unity comes upon this earth and peace comes upon this earth. It is through the Ahlul Bayt we're able to restore peace and justice upon this earth. And you see, in a society there's been whispers coming around from the outsides. People have been saying we need to do less fada'il lectures and we need to start doing different lectures. My only advice to you would be this: never give up on your fada'il lectures. Never completely eradicate your fada'il lectures. It was through this fada'il, if you go to any history book, you'll find Imam al-Baqir, Imam al-Sadiq, Imam al-Hadi. They would always stress upon the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt. It is through things like Ziyarat Jami'a al-Kabira of Imam al-Hadi, where we learn the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt and we keep alive the beauty of this religion, the beauty of Shi'ism. But the problem is, you know why they've been coming out and talking against fada'il lectures? Because of the way we act after it. We have to now rethink, what's the point of these fada'il lectures if afterwards we are not acting more like the Al-Muhammad? Think about it. Allah, when he talks about salah, he says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنَ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Surely salah keeps you away from evil and indecency. A man came to Imam al-Sadiq and asked him, how do I know if my salah is accepted? He said, look in between your two salats. If you've committed a sin, know that your salah was not accepted. Why? Because the point of salah was to keep you away from evil and indecency. Therefore, if afterwards you're committing evil and indecency, there was something wrong with your salah. In the same way, when we do fada'il of al-Muhammad and al-Muhammad, the point of it must be that it brings an improvement in our character. In the same vein, if we do la'na upon the enemies of al-Muhammad, it must bring about an improvement in our character. Have you not thought to yourself for your second? We pray salah to a God that doesn't need our prayers. We send salawat upon a family that has no need for our salawat. We send la'na upon people that are doomed to hellfire, whether we send la'na or not. What have we been doing all these years? Unless these things have an impact upon us. We are in those spiritual months of Rajab, Sha'ban, and Shahr Ramadan. At the end of Ramadan, in every single Eid khutbah, you will always hear, Allah has created us so that, as we say in Surah Al-Shams in the Salat Al-Eid, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Surely successful is the one who purifies his soul. And surely evil, and surely the one who fails is the one who allows his soul to become impure. Whenever you do an action, it must bring about purity towards your character. It must bring your character up a level higher. What's the point of saying wahwa and doing naras towards the generosity of Amir al-Mu'mineen if we're stingy within our lives? What's the point of talking about the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen's speeches, his eloquence, if from our tongues comes out nonsense and foul language? What's the point of talking about the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt so much if we do not become better followers of them? Read the ziyarat of Jami'a al-Kabira of Imam al-Hadi. You will realize how, you will realize the true status of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. You'll rekindle that love for Muhammad and al-Muhammad into your lives. You see, the thing is, I think we lose appreciation for this love. We become too comfortable in this love of al-Muhammad. We say that we are Shi'as, alhamdulillah. But this is a responsibility as much as it is a favor upon us. This is a responsibility as much as it is a blessing upon us. Imam al-Hadi in his speeches used to talk about Rasulullah. He used to start by saying, in one of his speeches, which is recorded by Ayatollah Wahid Khurasani, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praise be to him, who cannot be understood by our senses, who created how and created where, and therefore we cannot say where is he and how is he, who the depths of understanding cannot reach. Then he carries on and he says, Rasulullah, because Allah joined his obedience towards the obedience of Allah, Rasulullah also cannot be understood by a general person. He says, and also because the obedience of Ulul Amr has been joined to Rasulullah and joined to Allah, the Ulul Amr can also not be understood by people. When we cannot understand their status, we must do their fada'il to rekindle their love. But understanding the status, we must also act upon it. It is through this fada'il that we're able to liberate ourselves in our lives, gain higher positions. Think about it. Imam al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. When he was given the freedom to kind of preach in a university format, when he was given the freedom to preach towards people and to bring them towards his teachings, to teach to them fiqh, to teach to them chemistry, to teach to them biology, mathematics, we found that from his companions came people that were the father of chemistry, the father of algebra. And we show pride of this as well. We say that the students of Imam al-Sadiq were the ones elucidating things like chemistry and physics and mathematics. The thing is, the followers of Imam al-Sadiq today don't elucidate anything, only the history books did. Today, who elucidates sciences and mathematics and new research? Half of my professors at university were atheists. If we are the followers of al-Muhammad, this has got to bring us up a level in our life. We need to realize the true value of life. We need to realize we are the followers of al-Muhammad. We are meant to be setting the standard in society. Not the society setting the standard for us. Why is it that, for example, some people complain that we can find an atheist who have better morality than some of our Shias? We must be the ones who are setting the standard in society. This is what learning about the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt does. When you realize how high their status was, when you show true love for them, it makes you such a better person. That's why. There's one verse in the Quran I'd like to remind you all of. Allah says, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الخير فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى. Understand this verse. Allah says there is no compulsion in religion. Surely guidance has been made clear from misguidance. Therefore, whoever disbelieves in Taghut and believes in Allah, he has grabbed hold of the Arwatul Wuthqa, the firm rope. Go towards Ziyar al-Warith. Ashhadu annaka min da'a'im al-deen wa arkan al-mu'mineen. Wa ashhadu annaka al-imam al-barru al-taqiyu al-radiyu al-zakiyu al-hadiyu al-mahdi. Wa ashhadu anna al-a'immata min wuldik. Kalimatu al-taqwa wa a'lamu al-huda wa al-arwatul wuthqa. The Ahlul Bayt wa Urwatul Wuthqa. How comes Allah says in the Quran, those who believe in Him have grabbed onto this strong rope? Because it is only through the Ahlul Bayt that you gain the most purest forms of Tawheed. It is through the Ahlul Bayt that you gain the most purest beliefs in Allah and the purest servitudes of Allah. I'm not saying people who don't have Al-Muhammad cannot have a belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one of the prides of the school of Ahlul Bayt is that our Tawheed is better than any of the Tawheeds out there. Our philosophy beats all the philosophies out there. Our depth of servitude towards Allah is greater than any depth of servitude in any religion. It is through the Ahlul Bayt we gain the most purest belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Mutawakkil al-Abbasi one day summoned Imam al-Hadi to him. He found towards the end of his life, Imam al-Hadi used to get a lot of grief from the caliphs of his time. And Mutawakkil al-Abbasi used to often raid his house at night. Imagine you sleeping in your house at night and somebody raiding you one day, or somebody coming home to you one day, a policeman or a government person, just to check upon you, just to look at, just to see, check your house and to see you haven't got anything dangerous in there, at night time while you're sleeping. Imagine this happening continuously, time and again, every week, every day. Imagine you had children in your house trying to sleep and the government come home every day at night to come and check your house. This is what Mutawakkil started to do towards Imam al-Hadi. He used to go and say, he used to send people to check his house and to make sure he has no weapons to fight out against him, because people were telling him he might be starting a revolt against you. One day he summoned Imam al-Hadi towards him and he was drunk. And he said to him, recite for me verses of poetry. Imam al-Hadi says, I seldom recite poetry. He said, I insist, you must recite some poetry for me. He's drunk. Remember, he's drunk. Imam al-Hadi starts his poetry. He said, there were many of them who were at the peaks of mountains, surrounded by brave and strong bodyguards, living it up in this world. However, all of them after this glory came down to that, to 6 feet under in that small hole. Many of them came down from their positions of glory towards 6 feet down in that small hole. After their burial, the grave would cry out to them, where is your beautiful faces? Where are your restful faces at ease and at luxury? Where are those faces that used to eat and drink? Here, come today, the worms are now eating upon your faces. They say Mutawakkil al-Abbasi was drunk. When he heard this poem, he became sober. He threw all of the wine bottles and ordered them to take all of the wine away. Al-Muhammad always told us to remember death. We are sleeping today. We're not drunk, but we're sleeping. Perhaps the remembrance of death needs to wake us up, just like Imam al-Hadi woke Mutawakkil out from his slumber. Another saying of Imam al-Hadi, which he narrates from Imam Amir al-Mu'minin, Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. He says, it suffices for you to have good manners to keep away from that which you hate within people. Ponder upon this for a second. How many times do we find within society we will criticize other people for having bad things, for example, using foul language, or, you know, being a bad person in some way? Yet we find that the same traits are within us. We will backbite about others. We will say that they do this and they do that. Yet we do exactly the same thing. Imam al-Hadi narrates from his grandfather Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he says, it suffices for you in order to have good manners that you keep away from that which you hate within people. Because often we find it easy to criticize others, but we forget to do an account of ourselves. We forget to improve ourselves. We're quick to criticize others when we see something wrong, but we forget that we might be doing the same wrong ourselves. That's why Islam always said, practice before you preach. And as Imam al-Hadi came towards the end stages of his life, and they used to raid his house time and again, he actually recited a dua to Allah against al-Mutawakkil. And within this dua, it's a lengthy dua, a beautiful dua. Within it he says, Ya Allah, you now see that his evil is now causing me to lose my patience. I'm starting to struggle with the evil that he's putting upon me. And you found later on he'd be poisoned by Mutawakkil Mu'tamad. He would be poisoned by the Caliph Al-Mu'tamad. They would come to his house, Imam Hassan Al-Askari would be weeping. He'd be by the side of his father. Only a few hours after the poison set in, he started to pass away. Amir al-Mu'mineen, when he was struck, he still lived for a day or two afterwards. The poison that was given to Imam al-Hadi was so strong that within a few hours he was struggling to breathe. Imam Hassan al-Askari was by his side. When he passed away, they would see Imam Hassan al-Askari ripping his collar off his neck. They would come to him and they'd say, how can you weep like this, O Imam al-Askari? He'd say, when Harun alayhi salam passed away, Prophet Musa would mourn in a similar way by ripping off his collar. Today, Imam al-Askari, you're able to rip off your collar, come towards Karbala and Sham and look at the chains on the neck of Imam Sajjad. When the companions used to come to him, he used to tell them, can you loosen the tightness of these chains? They are causing me to choke. When they found that his shirt had fully become red with the blood that would come out of his neck. Come towards Sham and look at the chains upon Sakina. Come towards Sham and look at the chains upon Bibi Zainab and Bibi Kulthum as they're dragged through the streets of Sham. Today you rip off your collar, come towards Karbala and Sham-e-Khariba and look how they rip off the clothes of and the hijab of the women of Al-Muhammad. ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون. مات يا حسين يا حسين.
ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا اپنی آنکھوں کو صدا خون ہی روتا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس وہ تقی ہوں کہ نقی موسیِ کاظم یا رضا وہ تقی ہوں کہ نقی موسیِ کاظم یا رضا سختی یا قید کی اور زہر کا پیالہ دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس میں کیا کیا جس گھرانے نے صدا لوگوں کو خوشیاں بانٹی جس گھرانے نے صدا لوگوں کو خوشیاں بانٹی ان کو خوشیاں نہ ملی غم ہی زیادہ دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس وہ محمد کے جو رحمت ہے زمانے کے لیے وہ محمد کے جو رحمت ہے زمانے کے لیے ان کی نالین کو بھی خون میں ڈوبا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس سبز گنبد کے قریب مرقد زہرا ہے مگر سبز گنبد کے قریب مرقد زہرا ہے مگر باپ نے بیٹی کی تربت پہ نہ سایہ دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اسے دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اسے روٹیاں مانگ کے جس در سے فرشتے جائے روٹیاں مانگ کے جس در سے فرشتے جائے عید کے روز بھی ان بچوں کا فاقہ دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس وہ تقی ہو کے نقی موسی کاظم یا رضا وہ تقی ہو کے نقی موسی کاظم یا رضا سختی یا قید کی اور زہر کا پیالہ دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس پشت پہ جس کو بٹھا تے تھے رسول اکرم پشت پہ جس کو بٹھا تے تھے رسول اکرم اس نوا سے ہی کسر برسر نزا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا جس کے بازوں تھے ردا زینب کبرا کے لیے جس کے بازوں تھے ردا زینب کبرا کے لیے کیسے بی بی نے اسے بازو بریدا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا اپنی آنکھوں کو صدا خون ہی روتا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا ہائے سادات نے اس دہر میں کیا کیا دیکھا سورۃ الفاتحہ
یا علی اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم brothers and sisters السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Could we please recite the washafa for all the murid please بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه يكشف السوء 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 اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد Could you please recite Surah Fatiha for all the marhumin whose names will be appearing on the screens and for all their deceased family members and also for marhum Askar Hussein Jafar, cousin of Riaz Datu who passed away this evening in London. For Bario information, please listen to Stanmore answer phone. Brothers and sisters, just a few other announcements. Oh, just Al-Fatiha. On Monday, the 11th of April, ladies' class with Sister Sheila Tijani will start at 10:30 a.m. On Wednesday, the 13th of March, ladies' Amal program will start at 10:30 a.m. with Quran Tafsir, followed by A'mal at 11:45. On Thursday, the 14th of March, Jumu'ah program will start at 8 p.m. with Surah Yasin, followed by Namaz, Dua Kumail, Majlis, Amal of Laylatul Raghaib, ending with Ziyarat al-Warith. Thank you for listening. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Can we please stand for Ziyarat?
السلام عليك يا نبي الله السلام عليك يا حبيب الله السلام عليك يا رسول الله السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين سيد الوصيين إمام المتقين السلام عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء سيدتي نساء العالمين السلام عليك يا خديجة الكبرى أم المؤمنين السلام عليك يا حسن المجتبى السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني جميعا سلام الله عبدا ما بقيت وبكي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر الأهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين السلام عليك يا شهداء كربلاء جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا غريب الغرباء السلام عليك يا معين الضعفاء والفقراء السلطان بن حسن مولانا علي بن موسى الرضا كن شفيئنا وشفي والدينا في يوم الجزاء السلام عليك وعلى أختك فاطمة المعصومة ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا مولانا يا صاحب الأسر والزمان السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن الأمان 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 من فتنة الزمان عجل الله تعالى فرجك وسهل الله مخرجك وظهورك واجعلنا من أنصارك وشيعتك ومحبيك السلام عليك وعلى آبائك الطاهرين ورحمة الله وبركاته اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل الساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم صل على محمد